All right. Maybe seated. Praise God. Well, I look forward to coming. I tell you what, I hate to say some things because it sounds like I'm bragging, and I don't mean to do that, but I love this place, and I love this town, and I love you people, love this church, and your pastors. I tell you, you are privileged to be under their leadership. I'm telling you. The devil is trying to take out the generals. He's trying to do everything. And we talk on the phone sometimes just to be talking. And he always encourages me. So I got his phone in one of the very few in my cell phone. I can punch a button and get him unless he's in a meeting or something, but he'll always call me back. And he always encourages me, so I like that. And I love people like that, and I look forward to coming. And I don't like everything in the world. There's 41 different wars going on in the world right now. 41 wars all over the world. That's really something. I don't like that. I never liked my mom buying those dented cans. Do they do that in this state? If you, there's dented cans, you know, that you get them cheaper if they're dented. And my mom always bought those kind that worked great till a hammer fell out from under her coat. But anyway, oh dear, so we don't like everything, but God is good, amen? I don't like a date on sour cream, it's already rotten. You ever think of that, you know? And if your hair falls out today, if we could find out what kept it in yesterday, it'd be something, wouldn't it? So I'm trying to always figure things out. And they wrote books in the Old Testament. Where did he get the paper to write the books in? You ever think about that? See, I think about everything. And even when I'm witnessing, you've heard me tell it, I always think about things. Guy in the post office stand behind me, and I was trying to figure out how to witness to him. You got to open the door, you know, to turn around and say, you're going to hell. You know, that don't work. So I saw those wanted posters of the people on the wall. You seen those? They have those here, wanted by the FBI. And I said to him, look at that. He said, I was looking at that. I said, why didn't they arrest him when they took the picture? He said, what in the world do you do for a living? And there it was. I had to witness to him. So I figure all them things out, but the world's in a mess. Post office can't figure out nothing. I've been telling them for 6 years now. I wrote the letter to our postal guy, and he got a big kick out of it. But I said, let the Jehovah Witness deliver the mail there in the neighborhood every day anyway. You know, let them do it. It'd save a lot of money, you know. I'm always thinking of things like that would work out, you know. I tell him, Pastor, yesterday I went over the speed limit a little bit. My wife said, you're 3 miles over the speed limit. She's always correcting me. My wife is a cop's daughter. And so I have to, you know. So she's always saying, then she said to me, I want something fast. Go fast. I said, well, I can't believe you said that. I want something to go from 0 to 150 in 3 seconds. Whoa, I said, that's something. So I went to Walmart and bought her a scale. But not good, huh? Well, anyway, praise God. Isn't God good? You know, the world's in such a mess and chaos and so many things happening. And a lot of us have been through hell and high water, you know, but God is still in control. That is so good. And I'm so excited about a lot of different things. We are the first Saturday, whatever day that is, of August. I think it's the 9th, or is it?
Second?
Is that what it is? Okay, on the 2nd, I will be on radio out of Bethlehem covering all of Gaza. And we decided to do that. It's very expensive, but we decided to do that. I just felt this is the time. I need to do that. They are listening to that station. And I'm going to do some of it in Arabic. So I'll struggle through it, but they'll get a kick out of it. And if I say the words wrong, they'll understand it, what I'm trying to do. And God is so good. Good things are happening. And this year in September, my wife and I are celebrating 60 years of ministry and 60 years of marriage. Man, why? I don't know what happened. She took me right out of the cradle. I didn't have a chance. You know, just kind of the way it is. And because of that and because of several other, we're one of the very few, we were told, we're not sure, that have been in ministry 60 years without stopping, 58 years on the road. 2 years pastoring and then 58 years on the road, but 6 years of ministry. And so Forbes magazine, you've heard of Forbes magazine? They are, you can go on the web and get this, but on Forbes web, and it's connected also on Wall Street and 31,000 other websites that they're doing a story on me and on my son Nathan about a family that's making a difference. And they're just starting to do this. It's never been done before by Forbes. They've never featured anybody religious, never. And after us, they're going to do David Green of Hobby Lobby. And we hear that that's the next one. We're not sure. But I'm sure they'll be in there somewhere. And I didn't have anything to do with it. But that is good for us and will help us and bless our lives, I believe, with all the garbage that put out on us. And we are going to the Ukraine, and my son Nathan's going with me, and do a 10-day crusade there shortly. And then when we come back, we're going to Israel this week. Regardless of what you see on the news, CNN, Chicken Noodle News, whatever you see on there, you know, it's like the other day they showed pictures of some tanks, you remember that? And some cars were there. If you saw the license plates, they were 2004. It was 10 years ago. That's an old picture that they showed. Isn't that something? And people never keep up on stuff like that. And I got a call from Israel, said, watch that on CNN, because it's totally a lie. But there's 100,000 tourists right now, today, in Israel. 2,400 busloads of people touring Israel today. Isn't that wonderful? And I'm leaving next week with 80 people, and we're going to have a great time. And then we come home, and then I go to the Ukraine. I can't remember the dates, but we're doing that. And going to do a crusade there. And then we're going to come home. And in November, we still got a few reservations open for a November tour to Israel. And then right after that tour, I'm going to another country. I read about it, and I don't know why I do these things. I just cannot understand it. Too old to do these things. But anyway, I read about this country, 340,000 people. I didn't even know the country exists. I had to really research to look it up after I read this. It's 100% Muslim. There are no churches, no Christians that we know of in that country. And I thought, well, why ain't missionaries there? Why don't somebody go there? And my wife said, don't do this. And I said, I'm going to go. And so we've been working on it, and we have already bought our ticket to one country, and then we're buying another ticket to get into that country. And I'm taking in, and you can't even say the word Jesus or Bible in that country, or anything religious, heaven, hell, whatever. You can't say those words. You can be beheaded. And you say, that doesn't happen. Yesterday it happened in Iraq. Christians that did not leave or pay that tax were beheaded yesterday or died on a cross. They crucified some of them. And I'm not sure what all happened today yet. It's hard to find out the real truth. But this is a wild country. And we got a text from that country that heard our radio program. And that's how it started. That's how I looked it up and how I found out about it. And they want, he'd like to get some Bibles. Well, they cut your head off for a Bible. They catch you with a Bible. But I'm taking 10,000 of them in. They can't cut my head off 10,000 times. It ain't going to work. And the I brought one, and if you want to see it, I'll have it out in front. But here it is. It's not really a Bible. It's, well, it is, but it isn't. And it says, for the teaching of English only. And one page, it shows English, and beside it is Arabic, so they can make comparisons and learn how. And we bought 10,000 of these for $13,000. And we're taking them in, along with 10 tons of pharmaceutical supplies. And we got Johnson's baby powder, gave us 100 cases of baby powder, and big cases. I don't know how many is in a case. And then we also got 100,000 baby diapers. Brand new ones, not used. And we're going to take them in. So I'm believing God, and I think it's going to be a great time. And since we've had, and this is not a feel sorry for me thing, but since we've had threats in our life, we chose not to tell anybody where we're going till we get back. Absolutely. You'll be one of the first I call when I get back to Singapore. Maybe I can call you from there. I don't know. But we're only four people know, my wife and I, and my daughter and my son are the only ones that know exactly where we're going and when we're going to do it. So you just pray that God will bless us. Bless me. Take care of me. And I know that He will. Amen? Amen? We just believe that God will do all those kind of things. You know, people, I want to say this morning, this is important to me. People sometimes don't understand, and they quote things that they don't have facts for. Isn't that true? Yes. We hear that on TV, and we got a corrupt government and everything else. Thank God I can still say that without being shot at this point. But we have a lot of things that are corrupt in our system. I've seen that true, and we need to pray and believe that God will help our country. But people talk about the separation of church and state. You've heard that. And that's not in the Constitution. It's not in the Declaration of Independence. It's not in the Bill of Rights. It was in a letter written by President Thomas Jefferson to a Baptist church. And he said there will be separation of church and state. In other words, we will protect you. Do not worry. That was in a letter. But people quote it as being official and something that's documented in a government situation. It's not true. So people dream up stuff that's not right. That's why we need to pray and believe God. If ever we need to pray for America, we need to pray now. With a lot of our soldiers getting the pink slip and leaving, our military's going down to nothing, and they're laughing at us overseas, and we need to be praying. We need God to help us. Amen? I was in Washington, D.C., and the pastor of that church told me, say something political. I said, I try not to do that. I try to stay on Jesus and stay away a little bit from the politics. And you never know who you're going to hurt or whatever. He said, no, we have 1,000 people in our church that work for the government, at the White House and the Pentagon. They'll like it. They don't like the government, but they work there. So I told him it was nice to be in D.C. and to have the eBay is big, I said, in Washington, D.C. I heard you can buy anything on eBay. I said, one man bought a senator and two congressmen. And I got a standing ovation from the people. Oh, man, they liked that. That was a lot of fun. I got off of it real quick, though. And let that go. But they come up and shook hands with me afterwards and said, oh, that was good. That was good. That's how rotten things are here. But we need to pray. Amen? Yes. We just don't know sometimes where our country is going. This is not the country that we grew up in. No. I didn't grow up in a country like this. When I was 14 years old, believe it or not, I took a gun to school. Hello? I had a 45 long barrel. And a lot of guys took guns to school. And at lunchtime, we'd go out and target practice. And the principal would come out and say, okay, Put your guns away. Got to start school. We go back in. We lay them in the hall with the ammunition. And one guy that had a driver, I was 14, another guy 16, had a driver's license. They had a pickup, had a gun in the back window, shotgun, loaded. And the keys in the ignition and not locked. We never thought of shooting a teacher. Never thought of shooting somebody in school. That was, we didn't even think about it. There was no thoughts in our mind that were ever like that. So what I'm saying is, and they didn't sell water in bottles. We drank out of the garden hose. And my mother bought those dented cans. So those were the days, amen? Well, I got some of my books and tapes. If you haven't heard me before, I got different books and tapes out there. And we got a special thing we'll do for you. We'll even give you some stuff, so you need to stop back and take a look at it. Look at my seminar. We get more letters from the seminar than anything we have. We get a lot of letters from that. We thank God for that. And we're putting them in prisons and stuff all over the country, and good things are happening. And I got the bulletin this morning. You do it every time I come, sermon notes, and there ain't any on there. So I had to make up my own. All right? Praise God. I want to talk this morning a little bit about our thinking and how we need to change our thinking if it's not right. Thinking is something else. We think about things, you know, like when I was in one country, they fed me spaghetti and brains, spaghetti and pork brains mixed in the spaghetti. I can't eat something that's been thinking. So I couldn't eat it. I can't eat pork anyway. But anyway, I just, you know, I'm a Jew. I can't even play football. So it just was kind of wild, you know. And I think about why do we think the way we think? I come home, my wife changes the furniture around. I hate that. She said, I've been thinking of doing this for some time. Why was she thinking like that? It's stupid to think like that. Because we put that furniture in there 30 years ago when we moved in. And it should stay that way till Jesus comes. There's no reason to change anything. That's why I love the bathroom. She can't change anything around. Go in there in the dark. You can find what you need. And so she's always said, I'm thinking of doing this. One day she said to me, I'm thinking of going downtown and just looking. Women don't do that. They shop. They don't look. And so anyway, I said, I'll go with you. She said, we don't have to buy anything. I said, okay, I'll leave my money, credit cards, everything I left at home. She said, take one card just in case. Now, why was she thinking that way? We went down there. She said, drive here, turn here, turn. I don't need a GPS. I married one. And so we drove here and turned, went everywhere, and we finally got down there. And she got out of the car and looked like she knew where she was going, walked in the store. I'm with her. We went in there, walked down the aisle, turned this out. I knew there was something up. We got there and said, you see this little table? We need this. We don't need it. We can set stuff on the floor. The floor is there. That's what it's for. Set stuff on. And so anyway, we bought the table. Good thing I had the credit card. But see, she wasn't thinking about that. That was all a plan. It's set up. It's called a husband setup program. That's what it's actually called. And so anyway, people think certain things. I was reading in the Bible yesterday, and turn your Bible to Luke chapter 5. I'm reading from the King James Version, and as I've said many times, you don't need a King James Version Bible to go to heaven, but when you get there, one will be issued to you. And so, Jesus was at the Sea of Galilee. You remember that? The Sea of Galilee. It's the only body of water in the entire world that's called a sea that is not a sea. It's Lake Gennesaret. That's the actual name for it. It's about 8 miles wide and 20 miles long. And the deepest spot is 150 foot deep. I want you to remember that. And we stay at the beautiful hotel on the seashore. You that have been to Israel with us, stayed there with us. On the seashore of Galilee. You can look out. See the sea out there. Beautiful. And in the morning, you see men bringing their boats in. And they've been fishing when? All night. So Jesus was here. This is the setting of what happened here. And I want to show you something. Jesus was here. And in verse 4, he said, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught." Now, number one, nothing happens by chance with God. You believe that? Yes. Nothing happened. I led a man to Christ recently, and I said, "God wanted me to talk to you." He got on the plane, and he was sitting beside me. And I said, "Hi, my name's Ken. I'm a man sent from God to speak into your life today." He said, "You're kidding." I said, "No, that's why I'm here. You bought a ticket to get on this plane to talk to me? Well, I'm going somewhere else, but God had me arranged to be here beside you." Because the Bible said there's a man sent from God whose name is John, so I use my name. There's a man sent from God whose name is Connie or Ron or whoever, right? And we can talk to people. And we're going to talk about that tonight, too. You don't want to miss tonight. What time is tonight's service? 7 o'clock. You want to be here. We got something special planned. I'm going to talk about soul winning and how money, marriage, sex, and success are a part of soul winning. Very interesting. We're going to have fun tonight. How'd I get on that? But anyway, when I look at this, Jesus did something very unusual in that verse. What did he do? Number one, he told a fisherman how to fish. How many people here are fishermen? Anybody fishermen? All right, you're a fisherman. And if you go fishing, you don't need somebody to come over and tell you how to do it, because you know how. Isn't that true? So why did Jesus tell a fisherman, a professional fisherman, how to fish? That's crazy. Number two, he told him to fish in the daytime. They don't fish in the daytime. Isn't that right? Simon Peter even made the excuse, "We have fished when? All night and caught nothing." You read it. So now he's trying to do something here. Fish in the daytime. That's stupid. They never even do that to this day. And then he told him to fish in the deep. And that is crazy too, because in the Sea of Galilee, there are no fish in the deep. There never has been. There never will be. Except this one time. Because when Jesus tells you go fishing, you have to take your tartar sauce. Because you're going to catch fish. So what he was actually doing here was trying to change the thinking of Simon Peter. If you will notice and read it later in this chapter, he never commented on the excuse. Simon said, "We fished all night and caught nothing. So why should we go now?" And fishing in the daytime and telling me how to fish and where to fish. This is crazy. I don't do these kind of things, is what he was thinking. So I believe that Jesus was trying to change the thinking of Simon Peter. Sometimes our thinking needs changing. Yes. I asked a guy the other day, I said, "How's your church doing?" "Well," he said, "the pastor hadn't won too many people to Christ." I said, "Well, how many have you won?" Well, he said, "That's not my job." I said, "No, you're wrong. That is your job." Amen? Yes. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. He's telling all of us that. Pastor Ron is a shepherd under Jesus. And I go to Israel. I've been to Israel now more than any man on the planet. And I can tell you, I've never seen a pregnant shepherd. You'll get that on the way home. But everybody can win somebody. Sheep bear sheep. Amen? Turn to somebody and say, "I think he's talking about you." Amen. Sheep bear sheep. Everybody can touch somebody's life. And I believe that. That's why I don't win people, because I'm so good at it. It's just that I never give up. We talked to the waitress yesterday, didn't we? And I said, "I came from Washington to come down here to be in a non-religious church." She wanted to know about that. I said, "Yeah, this is a pastor. He ain't even religious." She was freaking out. She was. She couldn't. She's standing there going, you know. I said, "Everybody's got religion, Muslim, Hindus, Buddhists, Catholics, everybody's got religion." But I said, "The church where I'm going to in Chester," I said, "they have a relationship with Jesus Christ. They know the Lord, amen? They've been set free, they've been delivered." I and I witnessed her a little bit. We couldn't have long time, but had a little time to talk to her. And so I always do that. Fishers of men. Amen? Amen. So Simon Peter here, you know, what really made the difference in this scripture was that Simon Peter acted on the words of Jesus. That's number one. Acted on the words of Jesus. When you act on Jesus' words, it'll work. I didn't just decide after I got this text and did some research to go to this country. It sounded like I did, but I really prayed about it. And I said, God, number one, it's not a safe place. And number two, I got to go through security and customs and coming in with box loads. I mean, many boxes of these books. And I got to bring these pharmaceuticals. And when I went into Afghanistan, they want to know, what are all those boxes? I said, they're books. What are they? Teach English. Teach English? You have a book, teach English? My son, he's trying to learn English. Can I have one? Yeah, and I got one out and gave it to him. And another guy came over, what is that? And I told him. And before I got out of customs in Afghanistan, I gave away 80-some Bibles, I mean books, to teach English. Amen? Yeah, yeah. So you see, God knows what he's doing. And when I feel that the Holy Spirit has spoken to me and to get it done, it don't matter what it costs, it doesn't matter about the safety, it doesn't matter about anything. I'm just going to do it. I told my wife, this will probably be the last time I do anything like this. She said, I doubt it. But anyway, the thing is, we just want to do what we have to do. And you're praying for us, and you've supported us, and we appreciate that more than you'll ever know. But God is a big God. And Jesus was trying to change Simon Peter's thinking. See, I believe this is the church's greatest hour. I heard the other day that in China alone, over 30,000 people are accepting Jesus on a daily basis. A day. 30,000. Is that exciting or what? Man. And I was with Moshe Taranovsky, top rabbi of Israel, and he said the Jews, the devout Jews, hear the footsteps of the coming Messiah. They believe it's his first coming. We believe it's his second, but he's coming. And we all be excited about it. And I somehow, and I'm careful how I say this, but I know I'll have meetings booked that I'll never go to. Because I got a feeling that the Lord's coming is so close. Bible prophecy is being fulfilled. And he said in his word, all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. You'll be delivered up to be afflicted and killed for my name's sake. Christians are being killed all over the world right now. This new group taking over Iraq is so sad. We lost 5,000 of our soldiers there. And now that country is worse off than it's ever been before. And Christians are being crucified and killed and so on. People have no regard for life. Israel has film taken the other day of Arab women and children that are leaving the country. Of course, they dropped leaflets in and warned them for days. But leaving the country, and they were shot in the back by their own people. Shot their own wives and kids in the back. They have film of it. The world will never see that on CNN. No. I just do not understand some of those things that happen. Very sad what happened. Three Jewish boys were kidnapped. You read that? And they were killed by the Palestinians. Nobody said much about it. But then finally one Arab boy, one Palestinian boy was killed. It was too bad what happened. Felt sorry for him. Whether Arabs or Jews, I feel sorry for him no matter who's killed. And they killed him, and they caught the two Jewish boys that did it, and they're going to be put to death for it, for killing that one Palestinian. But nobody said anything about the other three that were killed. Even the United Nations didn't. Or United Nothings or whatever. So you say, well, what are you saying here, Ken? I'm saying that this is the church's greatest hour. There might be a day that we would have to go underground with churches in America. You said that'd never happen. You know, some of the terrorist groups are already in this country. I mean, we're letting them in. It's unbelievable. You can go through security now at the airport, TSA. If you're an illegal alien, you don't have to have an ID. You don't need a picture ID. So I went through yesterday in Seattle with my ticket, and I showed him a credit card. And he said, "We need a photo ID." I said, "No, I don't want to give a photo ID. You're letting the illegal aliens through without photo IDs. Why should you let me? Can't you let me through too? That's discrimination." He looked at me and he said, "Gaub, I know you. Give me the photo." So I showed him the photo. But he said, "I'm ticked off about it too. Our country's in trouble. Bible prophecy's being fulfilled. But this is the church's greatest hour." Man, we can touch lives. Amen? We can support. We can do stuff. We can give. We can pray. We can fast. We can do those things. And God is helping us today. So that's what Jesus was trying to do here. Simon Peter acted on the words of Jesus. We are born in this world to be victorious. We are born to be on God's side. We are born to live above circumstances. We all have circumstances that happen, things we don't like. And there's nothing you can do about it but trust God. Nowhere in the Bible did Jesus say, "Try to figure me out." He said, "Trust me." So that's what I want to do. Amen? I want to trust Him and believe that He will answer prayer. So then another thing Simon Peter had to do, and I do a whole message about the mind, but I believe that he had to guard his mind, number two. Number one, he acted on the words of Jesus. Number two, he had to guard his mind. You say, "You're talking about positive thinking?" You know, I don't know what you think about it, but I think positive thinking is a lot better than negative thinking. How many believe that? And so he had to guard his mind because, you know, our mind is a warehouse. I preach about this a lot. Our mind is a warehouse. What you put in is what comes out. I saw a cowboy movie the other day. I took 30 minutes and watched a cowboy movie. You ever seen one? Man, I liked it. There was no cussing. There was nothing bad that happened. They kissed with their mouths closed. It was a real cowboy movie. And they fought, and the bad guy wore the black hat, and the good guy wore the white hat, and they fought, they fell off the horse, they beat each other up, and when they stood up, they still had their hats on. Hats never fell off. And they must glue them on. I don't know what they do. But it was a great movie, and the good guys won, and the bad guys learned a lesson. And I thought, that is cool. That's really cool. You don't see many movies like that. You don't want to watch a lot of this junk. It's pitiful. Your mind's a warehouse. What you put in is what's going to come out. Isn't that true? So we have to watch our guard, our minds from all the evil things. Close the doors of our mind, the negatives, to what people say, what people think. Change your thinking. Close the doors of your mind to that garbage. Open the doors of your mind to the Holy Spirit, to what Jesus is saying, to what He is telling us how to think and how to be. And listen to what He's going to say and watch what we do and believe that He's going to help us. You know, I've said a lot along this line that if you say you can't do something, you probably never get it done. You say, "I can't do this." You probably won't get it done. But on the other hand, if you say, "I can do this with God's help," the Bible said we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And if you say, "I can do this, I believe I can do it," and you talk it, and you believe it, and you live it, you probably get it done. Isn't that true? So I like people that believe. That's why when I call Pastor Ron, he encourages me on the phone and lifts me up. I told my wife the other day, I said, "I like talking to him. I know he's busy. I can't talk to him all the time, you know." But I said, I like talking to him. So when I read this, I know that we got to guard our mind. The devil will accuse you of everything. The devil will come down on you with every kind of a thing he can. Isn't that true? And Satan will do things and people say things and your mind will wander and you'll say, "Man, I wonder if they're right." and say you're stupid or whatever. You know, your mind will do stuff like that. That's the way the mind works. It's amazing how our mind works and what people think. Isn't that true? Our job is to guard our mind. Don't let the devil put you down. Don't let negative people say it can't be done, it won't work, it's impossible. God is a big God. Amen? Like the two boys in school, maybe I've told you that the principal called their parents and said, wherever these boys are, there's always trouble. We don't know if they cause the trouble, but they're always there when trouble happens. And their parents said, well, talk to them. So the principal took them down to his office, and he told the younger boy, you sit out here, sit out here like you done with your brother. And took his brother in and sat him down, and he said, where is God? I don't know why he said that, but he did. And the kid sat there, and he said, I'm asking you, where is God? The kid jumped up and ran out of there. Met his brother in the hall, said, his brother said, what happened? He said, I don't know. He said, but God's missing, and they think we have something to do with it. You see, that's the way the devil will do. Isn't that true? The devil will blame you for everything. Guard your mind. Say, praise God, I know what I heard at church. I know what pastor preached on. I know what the Bible says. I know what Jesus says. And I'm going to guard my mind and believe that God will help me. Praise God and get me through. You were created in the image of God. Don't let the devil mess your mind. Somebody had a wreck in our town. Go to our home church. And somebody said to them, and they called me and asked me about it. They said, you think there's sin in their life? There's always people like that. What is wrong with people? You can have no sin in your life and have a wreck. You can be full of sin and never have a wreck. I mean, people say, his house burned down. Must have been sin in his life. Yeah, he got sick. He can't get healed, you know. Other people get healed, but, you know, he didn't get healed, so it probably sin in his life. That is a lie from the devil. You see, our minds need to think different. We need to change our thinking and say, God is on my side. God will help me. My wife's a wonderful gal. Some of you met her, you know, and she's just great. One day she called me and said, you worried about me wrecking the car? I said, yes. She said, well, don't worry anymore. She did it. She hit some ice and went in the ditch. So anyway, you know, there's all those things that'll come up. But our job is to believe God. So Simon Peter went out. And as he went out, his friends, the Bible doesn't say this, I made this up, but probably haven't. They were on the side, said, where are you going? We're going fishing. Why? Fishing in the daytime? We never fish in the daytime. I know it, but Jesus sent a boat. He said to do it, so I'm going out. And he told Jesus, I'll let down the net. He didn't say he'd catch fish. He said, I'll let down the net. Not nets. He's just going to try one of them. And he let down the net and caught so many fish, the boat almost sunk. And he called his friends, come on out. They were on the shore still laughing. And come on out. They brought their boat out. And their boat almost sunk. Caught so many fish in the deep. How could they catch fish in the deep where there are no fish in the deep? Did you ever wonder about that? So on the seashore of the Lake Gennesaret, I talked to the fishermen and said, why do you only fish where it's 40, 50 foot deep? They said, that's where the fish are. I said, are there no fish in the deep, like 150 foot deep? No, there are not any there. If you put live fish in the deep, in seconds they're gone. Why is that? Because they go to where it's 40, 50 foot deep, there's springs of water under the ground that come up, and that's where they fish feed. And they fish, so they never fish in the deep. So Jesus was changing the thinking of Simon Peter, said, you can fish in the deep, because I can put fish where there are no fish. I can make a miracle happen where there is no miracle. I can make something happen when it seems totally impossible. Isn't that true? See, God's trying to work on us. We all make mistakes. The Bible said all things work together for good. Do mistakes work together for good? No. They're not good. They work together for good. my little brother, 6 years old, fell in the river and drowned. I wasn't good. We had things happen in our family over the years. It wasn't good. My son died in a motorcycle wreck a couple years ago. That wasn't good. But I'll tell you what, everything works together for good. Life is 10% of how you, what happens to you, 90% of how you react to what happens. So when you react right and say, I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to do what Simon Peter did, I'm going to act on the words of Jesus, I'm going to believe him, I'm going to cancel the doubts in my life. I just hated excuses. Don't you hate excuses? I talked to my insurance man. I tell this often. He is so funny. He ought to be a comedian. But he tells me about the letters people write. It wasn't their fault. How they wrote the accident up. How many know that? The light's always green from both directions. It's amazing how that happens. And the lady wrote up this story of how her accident happened. It was not my fault. She said the telephone pole was approaching fast. And I attempted to swerve out of its way and it struck my car. Blame the telephone pole. She's driving in the ditch. But it wasn't her fault. Another guy said accident wasn't my fault. I looked over at my mother-in-law and drove in the ditch. Another lady said, it wasn't my fault at all. She said the pedestrian had no idea which way to go. So I ran over him. Simon Peter said, we fished all night and caught nothing. He's telling the Lord, you know, how can I catch fish? I fished all night and caught nothing. I'm a professional. I know what to do. I know how to do it. And I caught nothing. The Lord said to him, in essence, if you change your thinking, you'll catch fish. Because I'll put fish where there are no fish. He had to make a quality decision. Our whole life rises or falls on the decisions we make every day. Sometimes we've made wrong decisions, and because of that, our life takes a hit. We turn that around and say, you know, God will forgive me. And God will help me, and I'm going to serve him. None of us are perfect. I backed up and hit the garbage can one day, and my wife jumped all over me and said, you smashed the garbage can. I said, I didn't see it. I said, I was that close to being perfect. She said, yeah, right. Anyway, I shouldn't have told you that part, but anyhow, we say, God, help us. Simon Peter got it corrected here. They caught so many fish. The fish almost sunk the boat. And the Bible said that he fell down at Jesus' knees. Only place in the Bible they fell at his knees. They always fell at his feet. But here they fell at his knees because he was knee-deep in fish. I made that up too. But anyway, he was knee-deep in fish. I believe he was. And he repented and Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men. And you know, after this great miracle, they left their nets and everything, and they followed Jesus. Quality decisions are so important. My daughter said the other day, she said to my wife, she said, Mom, you need to talk Dad out of going to that country. And I found out this later, and my wife said, if he's prayed about it and if he's decided to do it, there is nothing on this earth that will change him. Unless the Lord said not do it. She said he's prayed about it. He feels it's God's will. And Becky said, well, Mom, you know, this is one of the most dangerous things. He's too old to do stuff like this. I hate it when they say that. Yeah. They keep saying that. I'm going to jump out of a parachute thing again. But anyway, maybe not. But anyhow, God is a big God. He wants to change our thinking. Every one of you have a unique personality. You have the DNA of God in you. That's we're made in the image of God. So that's we have his DNA. So that's positive. Isn't that true? If you think it's negative, you've got to change your thinking because that's positive. God's a positive personality. And everything he does is right. He never made a mistake. He never one time even came close to a mistake. Everything he did was perfect. When he sent Jesus into this world to die for us, he didn't have a second backup plan if that didn't work out. No, he didn't have, God don't have backup plans. We have backup plans. God don't need any. Everything he does is right. Satan came to kill, to destroy, to tear down, to ruin, to wreck. Any other word you can think of, that's what the devil came for. And that's what he wants to do to every life. And how we trust God is so vitally important, to hear the voice of God in our life. And if you are here today and you're serving God, thank God for that. Thank God for this church. Thank God for your pastors that treat you right and live above with all the hell and high water that come against them. Live for God. I know about this stuff. You know, it used to be when, over two years ago, when people would say to me, you know, my wife died of cancer, my husband was killed in a car wreck, our son was killed in Iraq, I'd put my arm around him, and I'd hug him, and I'd say, I know how you feel. God bless you. I'm praying for you. I didn't have a clue how they felt. I didn't know a thing about that. I thought I did. I was lying and didn't know I was lying. You understand what I'm saying? Yes. And then after my son was killed, a man came up to me in Idaho, and he said, Ken, I'm so sorry for you. I said, I'm okay. I'll get through it. I'll never get over it, but I'll get through it. He said, I know how you feel. And my thought was, yeah, right. You don't know how I feel. And then he told me, last month, my 16-year-old daughter was hit by a drunk driver and killed. I hugged him because right then I had to apologize. I knew he knew how I felt because he'd been through it. If you've never been through some, you don't know how people feel. So we have to change our thinking. Like Simon Peter, you think when he came back and he said, you catch any fish? Oh, did I catch any? I caught them where there are no fish. Well, how'd you catch fish there? I don't know. I had the miracle worker, the man that produces miracles in the boat. Yes. So see, if you've got Jesus in your boat, you got a miracle in motion. Yes. And it's coming as sure as there's a God in heaven. And God will answer prayer and God will work a miracle if we trust him. Isn't that true? I believe that. I wonder this morning, I just feel to ask this right now. If you're here and you need a physical miracle, would you stand to your feet right now? You see, I need something. Doesn't matter what the doctor said, but you see, I need a physical miracle. Just stand to your feet. I want to pray for you. I believe that God will answer prayer. I believe this. I believe that God is a miracle-working God. And he's interested in us. We have the DNA of God in us. Amen? Pastor Ron, you come and pray with me. Lay your hand on my shoulder. You that are seated, reach your hand towards somebody. Can you do that? Or if they're standing by you, just stand with them right there. Reach your hand towards somebody. Way over here is a lady. Somebody's praying with her. Find somebody. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, that we are on your side, and you're the miracle worker. You can help a man catch fish where there are no fish. That'll fill a boat. We thank you for it. Right now, Lord, you said by your stripes we are healed. Yes. And people will say, well, we prayed for people and they're still sick. Jesus, we pray for people to be saved and people die and go to hell every day. But we still pray for people to be saved. Yes. We never give up. So we thank you, Lord. Yes. And I thank you for your healing power touching lives today in the name of Jesus. Yes. And now, Lord, we're going to thank you right now. In Jesus' name, let's thank you. Lord, we praise you right now. In the name of Jesus, we give you praise and glory today. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. You're a miracle-working God. Glory to Jesus. You may be seated. All heads are bowed for just a moment. If you're here and you're not right with God, if there's things in your life that are not right, I want God to touch your life. Would you say yes to Jesus? You know, I got to tell you this, I used to preach good people go to heaven, bad people go to hell. That ain't true. There's good people that go to hell too. Good people do go to heaven. They know Jesus. But people that don't know Jesus, sometimes they're good. They have a family, they have a job and stuff, but they're not living for God. They're good people, and they die and go to hell too. So good people go to heaven, and good people go to hell too. So you might be a good person here this morning, I don't know. But while heads are bowed and Christians are praying, if you're here and you say, Ken, I need Jesus today. There's things in my life that's not right. Pray for me. Would you two just raise your hand so I could see it? So I want God to touch my life. Anyone in this audience, raise that hand today and say, pray for me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. How many Christians here would raise your hand and say, Ken, I want to be a master soul winner. I want to touch lives. Let me see your hands today. Father, thank you for these people today, all of this audience. Thank you, Jesus, for these people that have a concern to win souls. Thank you for what you're doing in their hearts and lives to this day. And Lord, even now, get our hearts ready for tonight's service. We're going to have a great time tonight. It's going to be different, but what we're speaking on. But Lord, I thank you for it. I give you praise for it. In Jesus' name. God bless you. You know, God is a good God, isn't he? And I really thank you people for praying for us. It means your support and prayers mean more. I can't even put it in words. I just thank God for it. You have no idea. God is a big God. And now with this, our radio programs, they're just, things are exploding. I can't even, I must be a person that has no technology at all. Because I can't even figure out all this stuff. I don't know how they send faxes through the air. Why don't it hit somebody in the head, you know? It's just crazy. Emails. What about all that? And now we're going to have pizza delivered from Pizza Hut with a drone. Yeah, that's coming right shortly. And books from Amazon be delivered at your door but with a drone. I'm going to shoot one down. So I can say I did it, you know. But now our radio programs, and we're now starting in August on shortwave all over the world. Shortwave, there's a lot of shortwave things I didn't even know about. And our program's going to be on that. And then we're on Facebook and Twitter. I don't know how it all ties. You have figured out. I don't know. Call my office. They know how. And it'll work. Or call Pastor Ron. He figured. Call Neil. Oh, where's Neil at? There he is. Call him. He'll figure it out. And I'm always looking, thinking. I gave Neil a little thing about that long, about this thin. It's got the whole Bible on it. It's a solar Bible. Doesn't need batteries. Can play forever in any language. And we're trying to find out where to get them. Neil's trying to help me with this, find out where we can get these things. I said, oh man, hold it in your hand. Nobody even see it. Pretty cool. So I'm for all kinds of stuff like that. But what we've got to do is do what we can while we can. Amen? Give God a hand of praise this morning. Pastor, God bless you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Got to change our thinking. We get programmed wrong. When you wake up in the morning and you turn anything on, you're being programmed. And I don't care if it's Fox News, CNN, or Daffy Duck. You're being... Or Duck Dynasty. Happy, happy, happy. See, I'm programmed. I can't help it. But you've got to get your thinking in line with the Word. And when you do, then things start changing. And you can talk, you know, I don't know if anybody else here, you can talk yourself into anything. Yes, you You can think yourself into anything. That's why you got to line it up with the Word. Line it up with those people around you that are in the Word, and trust God. Bottom line, we had a statement that was made here by Will, preached 2 or 3 weeks ago. He said, the Lord told him, I didn't call you to understand, I called you to trust. Which is so true. So true, so true. And as far as drones go, I'm not going to tell the whole story, but the government for a while, without them knowing it, was dropping Bibles with American drones overseas because of this man right here. It was an experiment in Iraq. It was Iran. It was an experiment. How many thousand did you drop? About 9,000 Bibles by American drones. I love it. And Obama didn't know it. We better stop there. Yeah. This won't be it. Got to be real careful. Let's give. Let's give. Our tithe goes to the church, and that's God's, and everything else is an offering. And he, you want a cash envelope? He'll take a check for, he would take a check for $14,000 if you would like to pay for these Bibles. That way he could be off his mind and he could move on to the next project. Then he has to pay for, he got the pharmaceuticals give to him through different categories, but he's got to pay for the freight to get them there. This is all not paid for yet. So that's what he does. That's what he does. I love his lifestyle too, folks. This man goes to churches of thousands, multiple thousands, all over the world. And he comes to Grace because he's the kind of guy that lives a normal life like you and I. He's got an 81 Buick that he drives. He just lives for Jesus. And I like being a part of that. That's where it's at. 2001 I'm in. What did I say? 81. No, 2001. Which is, this is 14. This is 14. Yeah. Father, we thank you. Write checks to the church. Everything will go to Ken. Father, we thank you that you meet our needs every day. You got us up this morning. You placed us in a vehicle. You brought us here. You put clothes on our back. You're going to feed us later on through the day. You're going to take care of us. You always do. And we thank you that we've got the opportunity to take part of that you give us and plant it around the world in what you've got Ken doing that only Ken can do. It's not our job. You give it to him, but you've set it up so that we can help support and take care of him and his family and all that he's doing. We thank you for it, Father. We trust in you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you'll pass the buckets, gentlemen. Go out. I don't know how many of you have bought any of Ken's books. He's got some phenomenal books. He's got a book out there called God's Got Your Number that is so, was his life. He literally was traveling, I think, with Carmen at the time. And he pulled into a place where there was, remember, y'all are older, remember the phones that were called a phone booth? Yeah, okay. Well, he went to the phone booth at this stop, and the phone rang, and he picked it up and answered it. Ken would do that. And that person had asked God for Ken's phone number and called that phone booth. Anyway, he writes a book about that. But he said it's been in print so long now that anybody else has access to that and they could put it in their story. But Ken was the one that happened in his life. True story. He's got some good faith books. He's got some really good teaching, CD teaching. So get the resources. This changes your thinking. This is what changes your thinking. I remember when I read that book years ago, God's Got Your Number, and I got to that part and I went, no. This is really. And yeah, it was a true story. Saved her life. She was going to commit suicide. God is so good. Let's stand up. Father, we thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. You've got awesome things for us. You're taking care of us. Thank you, Lord, your angels are around about as we travel today, as we spend the day doing the things that you've put in our heart. I thank you, Father, as we come back tonight, we're going to learn better, get better equipped on taking what has been placed in us and giving it to others and bringing more people to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We thank you for it, Father. We thank you for everything that's going on in our lives. We do trust in you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Call you blessed. Call you blessed.